Jesus, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is Father, He's Friend, He's Savior, and He is Lamb. If He did it before, He will do it again. You see, he's the same God who carved out a path in the ocean, who constantly makes ways in impossible situations. He is the God who calmed the storm with a word and healed a leper who was simply reaching out. We serve the same God of Abraham, David, Mary, and Paul, choosing the unqualified, broken people, yet working through them all. You see, we serve a living, active God, an unchanging God, a God who is constantly welcoming the prodigals back home. You see, if He did it before, I'm telling you, He will do it again. If He answered prayers from back then, He will answer prayers now. If He came in power back then, He will come in power now. He is the God who sees, and He sees you right now. So when it feels like everything is shaking, I want you to remember, He is secure. He is steady. He is unchanging and everlasting. He is the same God.
Well, welcome to Crossroads Baptist Church this morning. And it is with that emphasis, the same God, that we are excited to worship together today. And welcome. If it's your very first time to Crossroads Baptist Church, we are honored that you're worshiping with us today. It is going to be an incredible day. We've already had our sunrise service this morning at 6:30, and we've had our first service this morning at 8, and God has done some amazing things already, and we're looking forward to seeing what He's going to do in this service. If you're watching online or in person for the first time, we'd love to connect with you after the service. Please let us do that, and we would love to say thank you in person for being with us today. Brother John's going to come, lead us in some music. Let's sing together.
Let's all stand. We're going to sing about our living, risen Savior. Lift your voices as we sing this song, Glorious Day.
Came for to be born of a virgin.
Thank y'all are excited for Easter this morning. Love it. Let's sing another song this morning. Let's lift our voices and praise our living hope.
Silence, the roaring lion.
Church.
Jesus, yours is the victory. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation.
What a wonderful Savior we serve. Brother Chris, will you lead us in prayer this morning?
Amen. Well, I want to preach, but I won't. I'll say that to Pastor Heath here in just a few minutes. But welcome on this Easter Sunday, this Resurrection Sunday. I shared this with the first service. In the Gospels, there's seven sayings of Jesus on the cross. And one of my favorites is in John chapter 19, verse 30. One word, tetelestai. And it means it's finished. You know what was finished that day? Redemption. Aren't you thankful for that?
Yes.
I was looking around as I was standing on the side and just seeing the look on people's faces. And there might be some here today that have never had that redemption completed. Well, today is a great day for that. Today would be an awesome day to come and get it right and get it settled. And I was thinking about that word in addition. And again, I'm not going to preach. All right, Pastor? I'm not going to preach. But I was thinking of that word. And you can write down on a piece of paper every one of your sins. Every sin you've ever committed, every sin you ever will commit, but then over all of that, you can write one word, and it's tetelestai, because it's finished.
Amen.
Redemption is complete. Praise God for that. Let me read one thing, and I will pray, John, I promise, and then we'll continue on. We just sang Jesus Christ, our living hope. The world is full of despair and hopelessness. But only in Christ can we find hope. We just sang about it. In the world, you'll have emptiness, you'll find emptiness, but in Christ, you'll find completion. And it's all because tetelestai.
Amen.
It is finished. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you. Lord, we thank you so much for this day. As we celebrate a risen Savior, we're so thankful that the tomb is empty. And Lord, I'm thankful that the work was finished, that there's nothing I have to do. And I'm thankful that as a small boy, I accepted the wonderful gift of salvation. And Lord, I pray that if there are people today that are struggling with that, not knowing if they have hope or not, that they would settle it today. God, I pray that you continue to pour out your Spirit upon us as we worship you in song and in preaching here in just a few minutes. Heavenly Father, we love you. Christ's name I pray. Amen.
You can be seated. In just a few moments, we've got a special group coming to sing a song for you guys. But for now, would you please direct your attention to the screens once more?
When I think of the cross, I think of the insults and the mockery that came from the crowd. Think of a painful 39 lashes and the excruciating pain from a thorn-filled crown. When I think of the cross, I think of brutal suffering. the ultimate sacrifice that Jesus willingly stepped into. You see, the greatest act of love is for the innocent to stand in place for the guilty. And that's exactly what Jesus did when he stood in place for you and me. It's what we call grace. And in a moment of grace, far beyond anything that we could ever comprehend, Jesus took on all our anger, all our anxiety, all our brokenness, all our pain, all our past, every single mistake, all our shame. He took on all the things that we try to carry, but they're just so heavy. But Jesus didn't come just to simply take those things. He came to give us freedom. Because of him, you're no longer lost to your past. Because of him, you're no longer a slave to your shame. Because of him, you're no longer a prisoner to your pain. Because of him, you're no longer bound to your sin. Because of Jesus, we can actually take these things and lay them down at the foot of the cross. See, God's love has liberated us, you and me. Free to forever walk in the light of his amazing grace.
They all walked away, nothing to say. They just lost their dearest friend. All that he said, now he was dead. So this was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they seemed. Now he was dead and gone. The garden, the jail, the hammer, the nail. How could a night be so long?
Then came the morning. Night turned into day. The stone was rolled. Before the sun, death had lost and life had won, for morning had come.
The angel, the star, the kings from afar, the wedding, the water, the wine. Now it was done, they'd taken her son, wasted before his time. She knew it was true, she watched him die too. She heard them call him just a man. But deep in her heart, she knew from the start, somehow her son would live again.
Then came the morning, night turned into day, the stone was rolled away, hope rose with the dawn. Then came the morning, shadows vanished before the sun, death had lost and life had won.
had lost and life had won, for morning had come.
Oh, praise the Lord. We serve a living Savior. He's in this world today. Amen. He's in this place today. Praise His name. The Apostle Paul made a tremendous statement in Philippians chapter 3. He said, we worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh. That's our declaration today. Our confidence is in Him. Amen. Let's stand together, please, church family, if you would. Let's sing this great song of worship. Let's lift His name up. Christ be magnified. Amen. Oh, think about the message of this. Even creation longs to proclaim His praise.
We're creation, suddenly articulate. With a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from
may we hear it today.
We hear Christ be magnified.
Sing with us now.
Oh, Christ be magnified. Let His praise arise. Christ be magnified.
One day.
Every human heart is made in Christ.
Think about it.
Oh, then in one in rapture and
amen. Gonna be there.
We'll see Christ be magnified.
Let's sing it to the Lord, church. We're going to sing the bridge now. Think about this precious message.
I won't bow down to idols. I'll stand strong and worship You. If it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because You're there too.
It's not the doorway, resurrection life. Sing the bridge again, please. Okay, came in from the very beginning. I won't bow down to idols. All right, sing with us now. Here we go. Ready? Here we go.
I won't bow down to idols. I'll stand strong and worship You. If it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because You're there.
His transformation, how He crucified with you. Death is just the doorway into resurrection life. If I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise.
Think about it now. Here we go.
When you return in glory,
He's coming.
All the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing. My song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let His praise arise. Christ be magnified in me.
May He be magnified.
Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified.
Lift it up again, church. Sing it out.
Oh, Christ be magnified. Let His praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
Amen, church family. You know, we've gathered today to not only worship the Lord, but I say this so often because it's so true. We gather together. The Lord intended for this to take place. In Colossians 3, He tells us, so that we can speak truth to one another.
Amen.
We need, you need, I need today to be reminded of the truth of God. And this last song assures us of who we serve. Amen.
Let's lift our voices in praise to Him.
Children.
Serve. You can be seated. We've got another special song for you this morning entitled The Lord Almighty Reigns.
Thank you.
Amen. Take your Bibles this morning and turn to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter number 28. And I hope you've had a great day, great music already this morning. And I love it. Love it. It's such a blessing when Satan just tries to poke stuff. Isn't it awesome? And so thankful. You do all this planning and everything. It's like, you know, it doesn't matter. But you know what? At the end of the day, he's still alive and well. And Satan can't change that. So as much as he tries, it's still finished to tetelestai. And I'm so thankful that we serve a risen Savior this morning. As we celebrate the risen Savior, when we get to Matthew chapter 28, we see that not everyone was excited for that very first Resurrection Sunday morning. There were those who woke up with fear and regret and anxiety and pain and sorrow over what had transpired the last few days. Remember, just 3 days before, they had watched their hope be put to death on a cross. Everything in their life had changed when Jesus died on the cross. Everything would be different from this point forward. Just 3 days. 3 days makes a world of difference. They watched their hope vanish. Some of them were talking about going back to their old ways of life. You got to make a living. One of his followers had already taken his own life. Several of them wondered if they had anything left to live for. They woke up that Sunday morning with great expectations of what that one final act that had to be performed. They had to go to the tomb one final time for this last rite, this last act to be performed. It would be the last time that these ladies would see Jesus, the last time they would be with him. But as we know, everything changed when they got to the tomb. And in your life today, maybe that's a picture of your life. Maybe you came into church this morning expecting that when you walk out of here, everything will be the same. Nothing's going to change. My life is a mess. I don't have any hope. I don't have any help. I don't have any friends. I don't have anybody on my side. And maybe that's your story today. But I would invite you to go back with us this morning to the tomb. And see what they saw. Experience what they experienced that very first Easter Sunday morning. So let's look at Matthew chapter number 28 and verse number 1 just for context. And then we'll pray together and dive right in. Matthew 28 and verse number 1 says, "In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men." It became as dead men. What was it about the empty tomb that was so impactful that day? Let's pray together and then we'll dive in. Father, we thank you so much for your word and thank you for the power of the resurrection. Paul said in the book of Philippians that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Lord, help us to see what your resurrection involves, what that story means to us today like it did to them 2,000 years ago. Lord, I ask that you please speak to our hearts. Please speak to my heart. Lord, cleanse me of any unconfessed sin this morning and help me to be clean as I preach your word to your people. And Lord, I ask that you please speak to hearts. If there's one here today or watching online that does not know you as their personal Savior, Lord, please allow today to be their day of salvation and help them to see that their hope is found in the empty tomb this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're taking notes this morning, I want you to write down number one, the last chance. The last chance. As the previous chapter closes in Matthew chapter 27, we see that the tomb had been sealed and secured. There were rumors floating around town that Jesus had told people in certain settings that he would rise from the dead. And many of the religious leaders said, hey, we can't allow that to happen, so we need to make sure that it doesn't happen. We need to make sure that his followers don't steal his body and try and incite a group of people saying that he resurrected when in fact he was just stolen. But even though it was a new day, they came to the tomb like it was the day before. Nothing had changed as far as they were concerned. And with that feeling, we see, number one, that they didn't have hope. In verse number one, they did not have hope. We see a few historical details mentioned here in verse number one. The first is the day of the week that's mentioned. Their previous holy day, the Sabbath, was Saturday. But this says in verse number one that it was the first day of the week. This is Sunday. It was the day that we celebrate today. It's the new Sabbath day. It's like the Lord providing a new day for His people, a new day to celebrate, a new day to worship on. It's almost as if the Lord is getting ready to show something new, getting ready to start something new. But then we see at least two ladies mentioned here. We see two ladies who were faithful. We see Mary and Mary. All right, we see two ladies, but the same name. But what makes it interesting is the fact that in their culture, women had very little value and almost no authority whatsoever. And it reminds us that God speaks to those who might not have any clout in the world's view, but He does that on purpose. Remember Luke chapter number 2 when the Bible said that that announcement was made that Jesus was born, and that group that heard the news for the very first time of the shepherds in Luke 2, chapter 2 and verse 10, it says, "And the angel said unto them," the shepherds, the nobodies of their culture, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." Think about it like this. God speaks to the unexpected and uses them when He speaks to them. We would think, man, God's going to use this person who everybody knows and who has all the ability and all the talent and all the resources and all of the gifting. But God uses the unexpected in His service. God uses those people who we would say, they're never going to amount to much. I can't see God using them. And that's exactly who God uses. Why? Say, Pastor, why does God do it that way? So that people on the outside would look and say, man, nobody else would use them. God must have done that. God gets the glory from our lives when He uses the unexpected. See, He does not call the qualified. He qualifies the called. And He doesn't enlist those who have all of the credentials, but rather He equips those who choose to follow Him. Those people who make a conscious decision, I'm going to follow Jesus, He uses them. These ladies had no hope when they walked to the tomb that day. Their expectations were really low. We're going to anoint the body. Mark chapter 16 in verse number 1 says that they had bought spices to come and anoint Him. They planned to arrive at the tomb that morning, anoint a dead body, move about the rest of their day, not anticipating anything more than that. In their mind, they had absolutely nothing to celebrate, or so they thought. So, number one, they had no hope. Number two, they had no help. When you get to verse number 2, it tells us that the stone was rolled away. The angel comes down from heaven and rolls the stone away. We talked about in the car this morning, the stone wasn't rolled away to let Jesus out, but to let us in and be able to see that He's alive. It was rolled back so that we would know that He's no longer there, that the tomb is empty. But we see that they were wondering as they were walking. In Mark 16 and verse number 3, it says, they said among themselves, who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulcher? And maybe one of these soldiers would help them, knowing that it's the last time. Maybe someone would pity them, feel sorry for them. Maybe they could ask someone along the way that early in the morning if someone was out. But they had no help. And maybe you feel like in your life that you have no help. Hey, I'm doing everything I'm doing on my own. I don't have any help. I don't have any support. And maybe you even feel like that's the way God looks at you. You don't have any help from Him. You feel like you're not getting any kind of attention from the Lord. That no one cares about your situation or no one wants to help you. But can I just remind you and put in a plug right here? Jesus knows where you are and He cares about where you are right now. He knows your situation and cares. And it's the same Jesus, by the way. The same Jesus that we celebrate on that Resurrection Sunday morning is the same Jesus who knows and cares about your need today. J.C. Ryle said, our Lord has many weak children in His family, many dull pupils in His school, many raw soldiers in His army, many lame sheep in His flock, yet He bears with them all and casts none away. C.H. Spurgeon said it like this. I love this quote. A Jesus who never wept could never wipe away tears. And that is the same Jesus. Did you know, do you know today, do you know that Jesus cares for you? Do you know that Jesus desires to know who you are? And He desires a relationship with you. When we come to church, that's our job as the church. We're supposed to be the hands and feet of Jesus. We're supposed to show love and compassion. When people come in and they feel uncomfortable or they feel that tension, like nobody wants me to be here, and I don't even know why I came, they should feel loved and accepted and wanted when they come into a place of church. When they come into God's house, they should feel like, man, this is where I belong. They should feel that welcome home attitude when they come in here. You know, that means when I do that, that there are some people that I might not like that I have to love and accept. There are some people in my life that I might not get along with, but I'm still supposed to love. Some people I don't agree with. Some people who might vote differently than I would. And I have to love them and get along with them. You know, why do we do that? Because that's what Jesus was known for. Jesus was compassionate. Jesus was caring and loving. And that's who his followers should be. John 13, verse 35 says, "By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, if you have love one to another." If y'all dress the same, if y'all talk the same, if y'all have the same music preference, if y'all have the same bumper stickers on your car, if y'all talk the same way, hey, it's not any of those things. It's that you have love one for another. Are you loving those who we might say or the world might say are unlovable? We see they didn't have any hope. Came to the tomb. They had no help. Didn't know how the stone was going to be rolled away. But then thirdly, we see that they didn't know him. They didn't know him. We see in verse number 4 that the soldiers are laying over here passed out. They're faint as dead men because of what they saw. But then when the ladies get to the tomb in verse 3 and 4, we see what this angel's countenance, what he looked like. It says his countenance was like lightning. Wow. That's a description. It says, "And his raiment white as snow." This is what the ladies see when they walk up. They see that empty tomb. And while they come to looking for Jesus, they don't know this guy. He was not on the agenda. He was not on our schedule for today. We're not supposed to see him. I mentioned in the sunrise service this morning, how often do we complain when God disrupts our plan for his plan? See, God had a plan with this angel and a message to share with these ladies. And maybe you don't know. Maybe you came in this morning, you don't know somebody. Maybe you don't know the person who gave you the invite card to come to Easter services. Maybe you don't know the person sitting next to you. Maybe you don't know all of these songs that we've sung this morning. Maybe you don't know the preacher who's yelling at you right now. But I promise you this, just because you might not know all the answers doesn't mean that it's not true. You might not know the songs and say, man, why are they talking about the same God? Same God. It's true. You might not know what it means when we say the Lord Almighty reigns, but it's true. You might not know what it means when we talk about because he lives, I can face tomorrow, but it's true. It's true. Just because you might not know it doesn't make it untrue. 1 John chapter 5, verse 13 and 14, "These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life. And that you may believe on the name of the Son of God." Verse 14. "And this is the confidence that we have in him." Confidence. That boldness. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 11 and 12. "According to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him." See, our hope is all in Christ. It's all comes back to, do we trust him? Do we believe him? Are his promises true? If I were to say this morning, I have a $2 bill in my pocket this morning, and I will give it to the very first person who will come up and accept it. If I were to say that, you have a choice. You can sit and say, well, I wonder if he really does have a $2 bill in his pocket. You might sit there and say, well, what do I know about Pastor? Is Pastor truthful? Is he somebody who would tell me the truth? Is he somebody who may carry around a $2 bill in his pocket? Does that even apply? So then I'll ask the question. If I had a $2 bill in my pocket, and you had enough faith to exercise and say, you know what, I'm going to take... $2 bill. There you are, sir. Thank you. Appreciate it. That's right. I'm an honorable man. Thank you. Appreciate that. All right. You should have seen the first service when we did that illustration. It was a fight. You know, people coming up. Thought one of my staff members was going to beat somebody up. But you think about this. You were just sitting down front for that illustration, weren't you? Yeah. That's called cheating. But think about it like this. Promises are only as good as the ones who make them. Think about that. Rex, I don't think that I've ever lied to Rex. At least I hope not. All right? I've never lied to Rex. So Rex has no other feeling of, would Pastor be dishonest with me? He doesn't have anything to compare that to. So he looks at it and says, well, you know, he's never lied to this point. First time for everything, you know. But it's not going to happen today. So I'm going to take a step of faith. Because promises are only as good as the ones who make them. So here's the twist. So what confidence do we place in a promise made by someone who cannot lie? Every one of the promises in this book are made by someone who not will not, but cannot lie, incapable of lying. So do we trust that when he says what he will do it? Do we act on those promises, believing the one who cannot lie? So when he promised me that I can have eternal life, if I will come to him in repentance for my sin and I will turn to him for salvation, do I believe the one that cannot lie? When he says that you can have hope and you can have healing and you can have help and that you have encouragement and you can have peace in the middle of trouble, do I believe him? Well, hey, he cannot lie and he never has and he never will. But do I take him at his word? We see there's a last chance. Remember, Jesus is the one who said, the third day I'll rise again. He promised and he kept his promise. It was the last chance. But then number two, we see the living Christ. The living Christ. They had no hope, no help. And this guy that they did not know was getting ready to rock their world. We see that their sorrow was addressed in verse number five. Their sorrow was addressed. Verse 5, and the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. For almost every encounter with an angel in Scripture, the first thing said is, fear not. Fear not. Addressing their greatest need first. Because if you saw some dude who was dressed in his clothing looked like lightning, you'd probably have a few questions too. Fear not. There it is. Fear not. And when you think about it, this is a great picture of us. Because we are afraid of those things that we're unsure of or that are unexplained. Bigfoot. You're out in the middle of the woods, maybe tent camping. You hear that, you know, of the leaves and it's Bigfoot. He's real, you know. Or maybe it's zombies. Or aliens from outer space, you know, whatever. But the angel said, I know who you're looking for, and I know why you're here. I know. Doesn't that reassure you to hear that from Jesus? When we cry out to him, when we come to him in faith, believing that he hears and he's going to answer. Jeremiah 33:3, call unto me, I will answer thee, show thee great and mighty things that thou knowest not. Hey, aren't you glad that when you call, he says, fear not. He reassures us. The first thing we need to hear is him reassuring us. 1 Peter 5:7, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Kevin DeYoung said, God's way is not to show us what tomorrow looks like, or even to tell us what decisions we should make tomorrow. That's not his way, because that's not the way of faith. God's way is to tell us that he knows tomorrow, he cares for us, and therefore we should not worry. He loves us enough to reassure us that he's got it in control. John 14:27, Jesus told the disciples, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So if you're hurting today, you should come to Jesus. If you have anxiety today, you should come to Jesus. If you're desperate, you should come to Jesus. If your life is a mess and you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, you should come to Jesus. If your life is upside down right now and you don't know what the next few days are going to hold, you should come to Jesus. But with that being said, if your life is perfect today, you should come to Jesus. If you've got your life planned out and everything's going according to plan, you should still come to Jesus because he is worth coming to. Hey, he didn't go to the cross for nothing. He came to the cross so that we would meet him at the cross, that we would carry our cross. Because if you're going to be a follower of Jesus, let me reassure you, it involves a cross. There is no crown wearing without cross bearing. And if you're going to heaven and getting a crown, it involves a cross down here below. You will wear a cross. And we think, man, I've got all this on my own, and my life is peaceful, Pastor. But here's the thing. It was never God's intention for his creation to be independent. We were created to be dependent on him. Yeah. We're not independent creatures. I know we raise our kids to try and be dependent, you know, independent. And man, you got to get a job and you got to get a good degree and you got to get all these things. But here's the thing. We're supposed to be dependent on Christ. We're dependent on him. We have to have him. We see the sorrow was expressed. Number two, we see the Savior was alive. We see verse 6 and 7, he is not here. That same Jesus. He is not here, for he has risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly, tell his disciples he's risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. These ladies are standing with this guy they don't know, but they can see an empty tomb behind him, and he is inviting them in to see that it's empty. We don't go to a tomb today to exalt a dead leader whose body is still there. We go and celebrate the fact that he's gone. He's alive, just like he said. The same one who lived the perfect life, who healed people, who cast out demons, who died a horrific death and rose from the dead is the same Jesus that we serve today. The exact same one. And it's the same message today that was 2,000 years ago. He's alive. He's alive. Alfred Ackley was born in 1887 in Pennsylvania. Showed great musical potential as a child. His father was a musician, taught him all that he knew. He went on to study music in New York City and eventually went to the Royal Academy of Music in London, where he learned to play the cello and piano. Alfred later returned to the States and attended Westminster Theological Seminary. After he was ordained a Presbyterian minister in 1914, he became a pastor in Pennsylvania, but he never stopped writing hymns and music. Ultimately, Ackley was called to preach in California. He moved there, and he was working with a very well-known evangelist that we would know the name, Billy Sunday, former baseball player turned preacher. It was while preaching in California that he encountered a young Jewish man that challenged Ackley with posing this one question. And here's what he said. Why should I worship a dead Jew? That was the question. Ackley responded by saying this. He lives. I tell you, he's not dead, but lives here and now. Jesus Christ is more alive today than ever before. I can prove it by my own experience as well as the testimony of countless thousands. It comes back to our verse, Matthew chapter 28 and verse number 6. He's not here, for he is risen, as he said. You know, you think about with this conversation still circling in Ackley's mind, he woke up one morning and began preparing to preach at church that day. While he was getting ready, he was listening to a radio broadcast. And during that radio broadcast, a very well-known preacher started the broadcast on Easter Sunday morning this way. Say, good morning. It's Easter. You know, folks, it doesn't really make any difference to me if Christ be risen or not. As far as I'm concerned, his body could be as dust in some Palestinian tomb. The main thing is his truth goes marching on. Ackley was so furious, he picked up the radio and threw it across the room. Just furious. His wife came in and calmed him down, tried to get him to gain his composure because he was supposed to preach that day. And she said, if you don't like what he said, take out your frustrations by writing something about it. After getting home from church that day, after preaching a very passionate Resurrection Sunday message, I might add, he wrote these words, "I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives. He lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart." You know, while you might not know much about him, the one thing you can be assured of today, he lives. He's alive. And the main job from this point forward is to share with others the good news. Mark chapter 16 and verse 15, Jesus told his followers, "Go ye into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature." We see that they came not knowing what was going on, and they were assured, and then the Savior was alive. And lastly, this morning, we see that the saints are anticipating. In verse number 8, this same chapter, it tells us that they departed quickly from the sepulcher with fear and great joy. They weren't just a little excited. They were enamored. Their Savior was alive. And they had to tell somebody about it. Imagine the feeling of excitement in these ladies. We know how the disciples felt after they heard about it and how they didn't believe it at first. But remember, they came to the tomb to anoint a dead body, and now they don't even need those burial spices. They left them there. They rushed to tell everyone they could that he was alive. And he's still alive today. He is alive. They spent the next 40 days with him. And as he ascended back into heaven, in Acts chapter number 1, they watch him fade into the sky, and two men appear. In Acts chapter number 1, in verse number 11, two men who we know are angels said, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come again in like manner as you see him go into heaven." The same Jesus. See, he wasn't going to go up to heaven and die, and they were going to send a substitute. No, it's the same Jesus. Just like the same God who spoke in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 3, "Let there be," and there was, is the same God we serve today. The same God who led Abraham through the wilderness. The same God who led his people with Moses in the wilderness. The same God who took every single one of his disciples with all of their faults and failures, and they turned the world upside down. It's the same God that we serve today. But it goes farther than that. When you think about our life, see, it's not about knowing all the stories about Jesus. You might be here this morning and say, "Pastor, I've grown up in church my entire life. I've heard my grandma talk about Jesus. I've heard my parents talk about Jesus. I know all that." Maybe you've read the Bible through and through. Maybe you know portions of Scripture. Maybe you grew up in church. Maybe you've been baptized. Maybe you've joined a church. Maybe you are a member somewhere. Maybe you've gone through a discipleship program. Maybe you serve. But here's the truth. Salvation is not about knowing the stories. It's about knowing the Savior. And if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus and he doesn't know you, you're not saved. The truth of the matter is blunt, but it's simple. You and I both need Jesus. But do you have him? Do you have Jesus? Do you have that confidence in knowing that Jesus is your Savior today? Because if you got baptized, but you don't have Jesus, you came out of the baptistry pool a wet sinner. If you're a member of a church somewhere, but you don't have Jesus, guess what? You're a lost church member. If you follow Jesus and you say, if you don't follow Jesus, but you say, Pastor, I know all about these things that the Bible talks about, these important doctrinal truths, and I know I could show people some verses about Jesus, but you're lost. It doesn't make any difference whatsoever. Having Jesus is everything. Because if you don't have Jesus, you have nothing. Nothing. So this morning, it's the same God who raised his son from the dead, your God today. Is he your Savior? If you died today, will that same God know who you are when you stand before him? It doesn't matter what you accomplish in this life. What matters is, do you know Jesus? And does he know you? Every head bowed, every eye closed. We're getting ready to have a song of invitation and reflection, but before we sing, let me ask you two questions. Number one, has there been a time in your life where you've placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? Maybe you're here this morning, maybe you're a member, maybe you're not, maybe you've been here before, maybe you haven't, maybe it's your first time, but let me just ask you very simply, has there been a time in your life where you've trusted Christ? And with no one looking around, not to embarrass anyone, would you simply say, hey, Pastor, there's been a time in my life, I know there's been a time in my life I've trusted Christ as my personal Savior. I know that. I have that confidence. I know that heaven's my home one day. Whenever that day comes, I know that I'm ready. As a testimony to what Jesus has done in your life, would you slip up your hand and say, Pastor, I know that. I'm convinced of that. I know that Jesus is my Savior. Thank you. You can put your hand down. Maybe you're here this morning and you couldn't raise your hand, or maybe you didn't understand the question. Salvation is so simple because we needed it to be simple. If it was expensive or it cost something, we couldn't afford it. If there was something we'd have to do to earn it, most of us couldn't earn it. But here's what salvation is. It's in three parts. It's knowing that you need a Savior. Knowing that you're a sinner. The Bible calls us all sinners. No one perfect. No one good enough to measure up to God's standard of perfection. You have to know that. You have to know that Jesus died on the cross for that sin. He paid your price for your sin. And you have to ask him to save you. We don't get saved by default. And contrary to popular belief, we're not all God's children. We're all God's creation, but not all his children. And maybe you're here this morning, and I'm not going to embarrass you. I don't want to point you out, send somebody to talk to you after the service. I simply want to pray for you. If you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, I'd like to pray for you. I'd like to be your friend this morning. So this morning, that second question is simply this. Maybe you're here in the room and you say, Pastor, I don't know Jesus as my Savior. Maybe you know a lot about him. Hey, that's where I was when I was a teenager. I knew a lot about Jesus, but I didn't know him. And I lived the majority of my young adult life convincing myself that I was good enough because I knew about Jesus, but I didn't know him. And maybe that's your story. And if that's your story, could I be your friend this morning and pray for you? No one looking around, just between you, me and you and God. Say, Pastor, hey, that's me. I don't know Jesus as my personal Savior, but would you pray for me? Hey, can I be your friend and pray for you this morning? Would you, in the quietness of the moment, before we move any further, simply say, Pastor, pray for me. Would you slip up your hand and say, Pastor, that's me you're talking about. Hey, I don't know Jesus as my Savior. Pray for me. Is that you? Can I be your friend this morning? Pray for you today. Maybe you're here and say, Pastor, I just don't know. I'm not convinced. I don't have that confidence you're talking about. Pray for me. Is that you? I don't want to miss you, but I do want to pray for you. Pastor, please pray for me. I'm not sure. I don't have that confidence that Jesus is my Savior. Hey, man, if you're here this morning and you're not sure, would you talk to him about it? Whether you did or didn't raise your hand, would you simply talk to him and say, Pastor, or excuse me, say, Lord, I know that I'm a sinner and I know that I need you. And I know that you died on the cross for my sin. Please forgive me of my sin. Come into my life and change me from this day forward and be my Savior. Hey, that's what salvation is. Plain and simple. Because that's what we needed it to be. He loves you today. He died for you. He rose for you. Do you trust him to keep his word? He can't break a promise. And he made a promise to us that he would save us if we would ask. If you're here this morning and you are saved or you have questions, we have folks who are standing in the back at our tables that would love to talk with you, pray with you. The altar's open if you want to come and pray this morning. We wrote down, had cards this morning. Everyone received one on the way in. It says, bring them to the cross. You know, in our life today, every single one of us, whether you've been saved 5 minutes or 50 years, could be closer to the cross than we are right now. And maybe you would, we've been challenging folks to come and pray for those who need to come to the cross this Easter. Family members, friends, co-workers, neighbors, spouses. And we've been praying that they would come to the cross. But you know what? We don't just need to point people to the cross. We need to come to the cross. And maybe you're here this morning on that card and you would write your name down. And you would come and you would lay it on the altar as a symbolic decision of, I'm coming to the cross. I need to be closer to the cross. And hey, it's not some big shock if you do, because we all need to be closer to Him. No one has arrived. No one's perfect. We all need Him. We need Him to be magnified in a great way in our lives. Father, please speak to hearts today. Do what only You can do. Lord, we can speak to someone's head, but only You can speak to the heart. Lord, I ask that You please do in every heart and life of every person here in the room or who will watch the service later or watching online right now, or please speak as only You can. Please help us to come to the cross today. Help us to realize the power of Your resurrection, knowing what You accomplished when You died, but when You rose from the dead. We love You. Thank You for who You are and what You do. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand with us, please. Brother Tim's going to lead us with the team singing that song, Christ Be Magnified. If you need to come and pray or speak to someone, do that right now.
Were creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry in, from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Were the whole earth echoing His eminence, His name would burst from sky and sky, from rivers to the mountain tops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let His praise arise, Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. When every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry, oh, then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'll see Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let His praise arise, Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life, Christ be magnified in me.
Well, thank you so much for being here this morning. We're getting ready to be dismissed, and John's going to come and give us a couple closing announcements that we need to know about. But before we do, and before we're dismissed this morning, let me just encourage you. You know, we've got busy days, you know, lunch and family time and Easter egg hunts and all that stuff today. But do not leave without knowing that Jesus is your Savior. Our personal workers are here. They're going to be in the lobby. Our team will be outside. And we would love to introduce you to our Savior. If you have any doubt, any question, if we can help you, encourage you, maybe pray with you. If you're struggling with an area in your life, man, we would be honored to minister to you today. Whatever your need is, we're here to help you and be honored to do so. John's going to come, close us out. If you need anything, we'll see you outside. Visitors, guests, thank you for being here. Family members, I know we've got folks here, but thank you so much for being here. It's been an honor to have you at Crossroads. John?
Amen. What a great day in the Lord's house. I'm going to have you go ahead and be seated just real quick. Y'all been standing for a little bit. Just wanted to let you know about, first off, some decisions. Some folks we get to welcome into our church family this morning. First off, we have Miss Emma Hutchinson right over here. And we also have, where did, I just saw Brett and Alex. Brett and Alex Sandridge, where did y'all go? They've snuck out on us. Brett and Alex Sandridge coming to unite in membership with the Crossroads family this morning. So if you guys want to slip out so everybody can meet you on the way out, but we are excited to have these new members joining our church today. And I also wanted to let you know about the men. This is for you. We've got our men's camping trip coming up April 12th and 13th. If you haven't signed up and registered for that yet, you've got 1 week left. So go ahead and get registered for that. Just scan the QR code, or you can go on our website and look up events and get signed up for the men's camping trip. Always a great time. Today is the last day to order the Keep God First Crossroads t-shirt. So if you would like one of those, make sure you get your order in and get your shirt paid for today. And I'm going to let you know about one last thing before we go. It is Miss Michelle's birthday on Tuesday. So make sure that you wish her a happy birthday. She is turning 29 again this year. I'm going to ask Brother Chance Massey to come and close us in a word of prayer.
Let's pray. Lord, what a wonderful day to be in church. What a wonderful day to hear the message of the gospel. What a wonderful day to worship the Savior. We ask, Lord, that the message of the gospel will stay in our hearts. And as we leave this building, as we go out into the world this week, let that gospel come out of our mouth as we minister to people who don't know you, and to tell them about the same God who was born of a virgin, the same God who died on a cross, the same God that rose from the dead is still alive today. We love you, and we bless the name of Jesus. And everybody said amen.